This is Temple Run, running on real Game Boy hardware. Now obviously this isn't the original mobile game that was designed for the Eye operating system back in 2011. This is a version of the game that I wrote specifically for the Game Boy, a system originally released in 1989, around a year before the SNES, and well after its predecessor, the NES, was into its twilight years. This handheld would sell almost 120 million units worldwide in its lifetime. That's double that of the NES. But is it actually twice as good as the NES? Since I've been programming NES games for a couple of years now, I figured that learning how to program the Game Boy, just like they did back in the day, would give me a good perspective on the differences between these two systems and find out for myself which is the superior option. Brought to you in part by Brilliant. The Game Boy runs off a custom system on a chip referred to as the DMG CPU. At its core, it's a custom 8-bit Sharp SM83, which is a mix between the Zilog Z80 and the Intel 8080, although it should be noted that the Z80 itself is based on the 8080's instruction set architecture. This actually makes the Game Boy more related to something like the IBM PC than the NES. Though the Game Boy's core CPU does lack some of the 8080 and Z80's features, it does support a few 16-bit instructions, and the greater SoC package contains a built-in audio processing unit, picture processing unit, high RAM, and startup ROM, and this further connects to the system's 8 kilobytes of work RAM, 8 kilobytes of video RAM, audio output, 6-pin link cable, and the 160x144 liquid crystal display. And of course a game cartridge that itself contains the game ROM, both code and graphics, along with potentially other chips, such as a static RAM chip that could be connected to a battery allowing for long-term save data and real-time clock support. Compared with the 2 kilobytes of RAM and VRAM on the NES, it may seem like the Game Boy is clearly the superior system here, but take into consideration the graphical capabilities of each, starting with the NES, which outputs a 256x240 video signal. Inside the system, this is broken into two layers, the background layer, which is defined by a set of tiles taken from the game cartridge's character ROM chip, and a layer of up to 64 either 8x8 or 8x16 sprites that can move freely about the screen. The Game Boy, on the other hand, has a smaller 160x144 output, though this consists of three layers, the background layer and window layer, which, similar to the background layer of the NES, was a set of tiles defined from VRAM, and the sprite layer, which could display only up to 40 8x8 or 8x16 sprites, though it improved on the NES in that up to 10 sprites were capable of being displayed per scan line instead of merely 8. Both the Game Boy and NES only have 8 buttons, but while the NES has multiple controller ports and even an unused expansion port, the Game Boy had the link cable, which was capable of connecting 2 or even up to 4 systems together over a type of serial connection. Taking a look at the Game Boy's memory map, the system took advantage of nearly its whole 16-bit address space. Notice that it's set up to include areas dedicated to interface with RAM and ROM areas from the cartridge, and of particular interest is the system's VRAM section. Looking at this memory map, it consists first of 3 blocks of 128 8x8 pixel tiles, followed by 2 32x32 tile maps. Each tile in these upper 3 blocks are defined by 16 bytes of 2-bit per pixel data, meaning that each pixel is defined as having a color value of 0 to 3, corresponding to a different value from the system's color palette. However, it's not as straightforward as you might think, where each pixel is determined by 2 bits in a row. Rather, the leftmost bit in the first byte serving as the least significant bit, and the leftmost bit in the second byte as the most significant bit, together determine the palette number of the first pixel, and so on across the 8 pixels per row throughout the sprite. Further down in these tile maps, each byte refers to a single index of a tile from these upper tile banks. Either of the VRAM tile maps can be assigned to the background or window, though each layer can only pull tiles from 2 of the 3 banks at a time. But since the screen at only 160x144 is smaller than the 256x256 output created by the 32x32 tile map, only a portion of it can ever be displayed at one time. So certain hardware registers are used to scroll the screen value of the output window for both the background and window layer. Of course, the original Game Boy couldn't produce anything more than 4 shades of gray, and even then, it was only through some clever use of hardware. Through the original LCD, it looked something like this palette here, but most often in an emulator, it'll be reduced to plain old black and white. That's exactly why the Game Boy is so interesting though. It isn't just a normal computer like today's game consoles. It's the result of great practical engineering brought together through brilliant computer science. In today's world, we can often feel compelled to focus on only one single discipline. But with today's sponsor Brilliant, you're able to learn by doing through thousands of interactive lessons on data analysis, math, programming, and more. Each lesson on Brilliant has been created by teachers and researchers from among the top universities and companies in the US, and they're filled with opportunities for hands-on problem solving that give you a deeper understanding of whatever you're trying to learn. Rather than focusing on rote memorization, Brilliant builds your critical thinking while you build real knowledge through their fun, bite-sized lessons that are perfect for improving your personal or professional skills through mere minutes of practice every day. So to try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/inkbox. Or click on the top link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Again, that's brilliant.org/inkbox. With a basic understanding of the system's architecture, it's time to begin writing some actual code for the Game Boy, but not before setting up the right programming tools. I'll be using a version of assembly called RGBASM, which is based on the syntax of assembly for the Z80 CPU. I'll be compiling this code through the assembler, linker, and fixer provided by the Rednex Game Boy Development System, a really great open source project whose roots date back all the way to 1996. After a little basic file setup here to define the correct segments at the proper memory locations and leave enough room for the file header, it's finally time to start really hitting the keys. For this first attempt, I'm going to keep it simple by recreating everyone's favorite made in China but Japan made it way cooler game, Rock, Paper, Scissors. To start, I'll design the tile graphics in YYCHR, which has a special mode to accommodate the unconventional Game Boy tile data. Here, I've made both a 16x16 and 8x8 version of Rock, Paper, and Scissors, and I can save this as a regular binary file. I can include this file straight into the source code in order to use some of these graphics as sprites in the game. Then, on startup, I can load up all these tiles, which are located in ROM, into the three blocks of tiles in VRAM. Then I can define each sprite with 4 bytes of data representing the sprite's Y position minus 16 pixels, the X position minus 8 pixels, the tile index, and the sprite's attributes. This XY offset may seem a little strange, but it's actually a really useful feature. Back on the NES, when a sprite was defined with location 00, it would show up in the top left corner of the screen. So if you just initialized a sprite but you didn't want to see it yet, you'd have to explicitly hide it by setting the Y value to 240. On the Game Boy, sprites at location 00 will always be hidden off-screen, whether they're 8x8 or 8x16. It's just one less thing that you have to worry about, and a feature I'm really happy the Nintendo engineers put in. These 16 bytes here should define 4 sprites, and I can either copy these to the object attribute memory area before the LCD turns on, or through a direct memory access transfer during the screen's vertical blank period. I'll compile and link this code and then throw it through the fixer as a final step in order to complete the very specific file header that is required. On a real cartridge, this would include the game's name, the company who made it, what kind of hardware was to be found on the cartridge, like more ROM, RAM, or what specific mapper is being used, along with a copy of Nintendo's logo. This is a copy of the logo that scrolls down the screen during the Game Boy startup. It was supposed to be an anti-piracy measure, but courts later ruled in Sega vs. Accolade that a company could not use one's trademark as means of security. For now, I'll be running this new GB file I just created on the emulicious Game Boy emulator, and just as was hoped, here are our 4 sprites in the center of the screen. The plan for this first program is to allow the player to select one of the 3 options here, then run a slot machine-like animation that reveals both your choice and the computer's choice. This can be very easily accomplished by slapping a bunch of rocks, papers, and scissors in 2 columns on the background layer, and then using a window layer as an overlay to show only a single one. As mentioned before, the window layer is opaque, so it will completely cover the background when it's turned on. While that might not seem very useful, it is possible to change the LCD mode to turn the window on and off at certain times during the LCD refresh. The program can be initialized by setting the LCD mode to draw the window and sprites. Then by setting certain registers, the system can be told to raise an interrupt when the LCD update reaches a certain scan line. At that moment, the LCD mode can be changed to draw only the background. Then, after a few more lines, another interrupt is raised and the window and sprites can be turned on once again. This technique is used all over Game Boy games to draw HUDs or other information on the screen. Through getting the user's input from the buttons by reading from another hardware register, the user can select either rock, paper, or scissors, moving the sprite cursor along with their selection. And then by pressing either A or B, it will cause the computer to select a random number from 0 to 2 through a pseudo number random generation sequence helped by the new 16-bit instructions, randomize the background layer tiles, and then scroll all the way back up to the top, dramatically revealing the winner. The player's current win streak and max win streak are recorded on a provided SRAM chip in the cartridge, one that in hardware would be backed by a battery, but on an emulator it will merely create an associated file. To try this game out on real hardware, I can copy this .gb file onto an SD card, and then put that into a flash card like this one here, the Easy Flash Junior. Let's put this in and boot up the game, and it seems to be working just as intended. And like I always say, if you play paper all the time, you win half the time. But this game is certainly more colorful than I designed it to be, and that's because I'm not playing this on a regular Game Boy, I'm playing it on a Game Boy Color. Though some people like to think of the Game Boy Color as the sequel to the Game Boy, it's really more like Lion King 1.5 than Lion King 2. That's partially because after having such a successful decade, Nintendo wasn't really looking to push out their new 32-bit handheld system they were working on. But given the recent flop of the Virtual Boy, it forced their hand to get something out the door as a stopgap before their 32-bit machine was ready. Enter the Game Boy Color. Released in late 1998, hardware-wise, this new Game Boy was outfitted with a new SoC designated the CGB that at its core was the same, but was capable of running up to double the clock speed of the Game Boy's original DMG CPU. The system was upgraded from 8 kilobytes of working RAM to 32 kilobytes, and VRAM was not only doubled from 8 kilobytes to 16 kilobytes, but was also moved into the SoC itself. But since the memory map was already full, the Game Boy Color makes use of bank switching to allow access to all this new RAM. And the biggest upgrade of all was, of course, the brand new Color LCD, capable of displaying up to 32,768 unique colors. The rest of the system's architecture remaining the same allowed for plain old Game Boy games to run not just as normal, but enhanced with color. This is where bank switching comes into play. With the VRAM now being split into two 8-kilobyte banks, Game Boy Color games can first now store twice as many tiles as before, but the background and window tile maps still only exist in bank 0, while bank 1 contains a new attribute map for each tile map. This new map has 1 byte per tile that can make that tile flip around, set the bank source, define which of the 8 color palettes to use, make it do the hokey pokey, and so on. So when an original Game Boy game is run on a Game Boy Color, the system will automatically assign a color palette to that game. It then operates as normal because the game code doesn't make use of any of these new CGB features. Game Boy Color games, on the other hand, can define for themselves 8 unique background and 8 unique sprite color palettes at a time. Background palettes, used by the background and window, consist of 4 colors each, defined by 5 bits of red, blue, and green. While sprite palettes consist of 3 colors plus 1 default transparent color. Sprites also luckily just happen to have 3 free bits in their OAM attribute byte, so that's where they get assigned their color palette. So now it's finally time to start my original goal, Temple Run for the Game Boy Color. But there are actually 2 kinds of CGB games, Game Boy Color exclusive games, and Game Boy Color compatible games. The difference being that the exclusive titles make full use of the system's expanded memory banks, double CPU speed mode, and other features, whereas compatible games really only use the new color features, but that also makes them still playable on the original Game Boy. For now, I'm going to design Temple Run as a compatible game, which means that all the artwork I'm going to design should look good with the original black and white palette as well. After that, I can define different units of the path the player will run down. These will be loaded into the game and the corresponding graphics displayed on the background layer. Each tile will correspond to one of the predefined color palettes. I wrote this little test program here to see if we can get color working, so let's boot that up and wow. After seeing only black and white for so long, it feels like I'm in one of those fake colorblind glasses videos right now. But anyways, as for the player, I definitely haven't taken any inspiration from other classic running games, so if there's any other resemblance to round characters with shoes, it's merely a coincidence here. After setting up an animation where the player's sprites flash back and forth between the different running frames, I can also set the background to scroll down at a certain speed. Then for every 10 tiles it scrolls, a new random unit will be loaded in. Since it's not actually safe to edit VRAM directly when the LCD is updating the screen, which is most of the time, I can copy whatever I need to load into a buffer and then quickly feed it over when the timing is more convenient for the system. I can also fill up some of the leftover sprites with coins for the player to collect. Now, I could have just done a bunch of checks to see if the coin spawned on a suitable tile or not, but rather than write all that out, I just randomly spawned the coin in one of three columns with a little logic to have them chained together, and then scroll them down at the same speed as the background scrolls to give the illusion of them moving together. With this simple approach, sometimes coins spawn in places that can't be collected, but let's call that a metaphor for life. When it comes to turning, that's a bit harder. Unlike the SNES, there aren't any additional special graphics modes for tile map translation to do cool animations. So I settled on just switching the player back to a straight unit when they moved left or right whenever a turn is able to be taken. I'll be honest, it does feel like I'm cutting corners a little here. Every frame, the program will check to see if the player has run into any tiles that will cause the player to begin a death animation, like into a hole, a wall, or water. This will take the player back to the title screen, and I always kind of brush over the title screens, but these can be as intricate as the main game itself. It requires setting up the background layer with the right map of tiles and color palettes, displaying data from the SRAM chips like your total coin count, high score, and your last run score, and I haven't even mentioned the hats yet. Okay, look at this. The player can choose to wear one of three different hats. No DLC, no in-app purchases, just all the hats right there. Now, well, maybe you're thinking, you should have made it so that you unlock them through coins or through a certain high score level. Well, that would have been better game design, yeah, but I didn't even finish the crocodile unit, so maybe in version 1.1. What I can say is that programming the Game Boy is a whole lot of fun, and while I still have a lot to learn before I master this system, I do think that there are certain advantages that the Game Boy holds over the NES. But the story of the Game Boy also reminds me a lot of the Nintendo Switch right now. It's a console that's been around for nearly a decade, and Nintendo isn't necessarily looking to push out that next-gen upgrade since it's just so successful right now. So could the next big release have been under our noses the whole time? The Nintendo Switch Color? I've linked all the resources I used in the description if you want to try programming the system for yourself. Links to Brilliant once again, check them out down below, and until next time.